You can be seated. Oh, that was awesome. I think we bless them, but just bless these guys again. Well, how many of you were here last Sunday morning? Awesome. How many were not? You're forgiven. I forgive you. Offended, but forgiven. I started a series called Cultures That Cultivate World Changers, and I wanted to do part two of that. So why don't you just grab a hand of the person next to you. And again, one of the ways we change the world is by getting married. So if you'd like to just date the person next to you, feel free to just give them a little squeeze in the middle of the prayer. As Bill said this morning, sometimes things come to you while you're praying and you don't think it's the Lord, but then a picture of the woman sitting next to you comes to your mind, and you're looking for a woman and she's sitting next to you, and it's just like being at the well. Like Jacob at the well. Like this is like, yeah, fishing at the hatchery right here. Pull up. All right, so Holy Spirit, we pray for your grace to be on this day, on this night, whatever it is, day someplace. And we bless this time, and we pray for you, God, to lead our interaction tonight. We pray that there would be an anointing on the word tonight. Amen. Last week, I talked about an encounter that Kathy and I had, and I'll just give you the very short version. We had some folks come over, and we were doing a new blog site, so we needed some new photographs. And Kathy and I, actually, we have this in common. We both hate taking pictures. And so we were not looking forward to the evening, if it was going to be done in the evening. Like, they were coming over at 6 o'clock in our house, and we synergized in depression, which was really cool. We were really having a good time. You ever throw a pity party and just nobody comes? And the person you don't want to come is the happy person, right? Do not come and make us happy. And so we were kind of going through this, at about 5 o'clock, Kathy's like, they're going to be here in an hour. You should change your clothes. And so we were doing that kind of thing. And then they got to her house and knocked on the door. And she said, it's your thing. You answer the door. I'm like, all right. So I answer the door. You know, I get paid to be happy, you know. So I answer the door. Hello. Like, you know, yeah, we already have a Photoshop smile. So like, hi. And, you know, it was a hippie and his two friends. And we come to take your picture. I'm like, awesome. Yeah, we've been looking forward to it. Liar, liar. You know, it was that whole thing. They're like, we brought you strawberries and chocolate. All right, thank you. Kathy, they brought us strawberries and chocolate. Okay, good. And then they said, well, we'll look around the yard and we'll find some places to take some photographs. I'm like, okay. So we're inside just kind of waiting for them to come in and still not having a very good evening. And finally they're like, hey, come on out. And so they start taking pictures of us and they're like, oh. And as soon as they saw me, I forgot this part. I had changed my shirt and I was wearing this blue shirt. And they're like, I answered the door and they're oh yeah, we couldn't. Oh, look at that shirt. And, you know, the hippie guy. And the two girls were like, yeah. I think they practiced before they came. Like, that shirt looks amazing on you. It goes with your eyes. I'm like, I think anything goes with brown, actually, you know? And so they're like, oh, that's really... And then they see Kathy like, oh, you look amazing. And she's like, thank you. Oh, that just looks so good. Oh, these pictures are just going to be beautiful. They're just going to be beautiful. And I don't know how they do it, but they were synergizing. I don't know if it was the spirit or if it was like some kind of like synchronized swimming thing they were doing. So when one person would say something, the other two would like, you know, at two or three witnesses, they were like, yeah, oh, that's amazing. That's, oh, and they were doing that. Like, so we go outside finally. They're like, come outside. So we go outside and we're taking some pictures. There's three cameras going there. And they're saying things. They're looking at this little screen like, oh, that is you two should be models. That should be on a magazine. And the other two like, yeah, oh, yeah. So they took about 50 pictures of us first. And then they're like, you want to see these? I'm like, yeah, sure. So they're looking at, we're all looking at the same screen. I'm looking at an old fat man. They're like, that is amazing. They were supposed to be over for 2 hours, which we were not looking forward to. They ended up there 3 hours because after a while, I started to believe that I looked amazing. I'm like, hey, take some pictures of me in my office. Over here. Kathy's like, hey, I got some horses. I'd like to take a picture with the horses. So they were there till late at night. And craziest thing happened. The next morning, I woke up without trying, and I thought, I look so good this morning. I was looking in the mirror. My hair was all, whew. I'm like, that is amazing. And it continued for like 4 more days. I'm like, man, I don't know what that is, but we need to take pictures like once a week. And I began to realize, and actually, the truth is, after that, that all really happened, just almost exactly like that. It was not quite that funny, but pretty close. They leave, and we're sitting on the couch after they left. It's about 9 o'clock at night. It's like 3 hours photo shoot. And I looked over at Kathy, and we simultaneously said, what just happened to us? I said, I don't know, but whatever it is, I want more of that. And for the next several days, I woke up thinking, I look so good. I mean, I wasn't trying to. I just thought, I look so good. I'm over it now. Don't worry. I'm back to like, oh, man, yikes. Take that down. I preached in Europe, and they had the, you probably have done this before. They have a screen right here. It's about this big, a picture of you. I mean, it's just, it's that, but it's right there. So you can't possibly ignore it. Well, your preacher's like, oh my goodness. It's so hard to suck in that long. It's hard to make a point where I sounded like I was having puberty the whole time I was preaching. Whatever, anyway. Man, something happens when somebody thinks you're beautiful, you know? So it really had a profound effect on my attitude the whole week. I really did wake up thinking, I'm beautiful. Wow, that's amazing. And I am surprised, as you are, that it had that kind of effect. But when someone for 3 hours is telling you how beautiful you are, you start to believe it. I mean, even if you're ugly, you start to believe it. And it just began to cultivate, again, the same theme in me that when somebody begins to believe in you more than you believe in yourself, it just does something to you. You know, we're saved when we believe in Jesus, but we're changed when we realize he believes in us. And I was just... taken by the verse, and Bill shared again this morning, Acts 9:26. And this is the story. In fact, Bill told a story this morning about Saul. Saul has an encounter with God, and he's on the ground, and the Lord blinds him and says to him, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he says, Who are you, Lord? He said, I am Jesus who you are persecuting. And he tells him where to go, and just to fast forward through the whole story, he ends up at this place completely blind and tells a young disciple named Ananias, gives him a Sean Bolts kind of word of knowledge. Here's this guy's address. I want you to go there. I want you to tell him these things. He's going to speak before kings and Gentiles, and he's going to be my servant. And of course, Ananias, this, you know, Saul's famous for, he's kind of the, you know, ISIS of his day, head of ISIS, you know. Ananias is like, no, Lord. He's like, no, he's my servant. So Ananias goes and says, Brother Saul, which is really cool. Between the time God speaks to Ananias and the time he gets to Saul's place, Saul's staying, he's already decided that he's a brother. So he gives him this prophetic word. You're going to speak to kings. You're going to minister to the Gentiles. You're going to be a servant of God. And so immediately Saul, you know, tries to do exactly what he just was prophesied that he's supposed to do, and he starts going out, and of course he's in no man's land because the people he was with don't like him, and the people he's supposed to be with don't trust him. by the way, some of you are there. No, I'm not being funny. I just had this thought. Some of you are in that no man's land. Like the people you used to be with don't like you. And the people you're supposed to be with don't trust you. Wow. No, I'm not being, I know I'm being funny at times, but I'm not being funny. I just feel like a prophetic word. Like for some people, maybe it's even Bethel TV, but you're just in that place. And I just want to say, don't go back to the place you were. And by the way, I think, I don't know. Okay, I'm just going to say this. This is not a theological statement. I haven't thought through it. We might cut it on the streamy. Sometimes the people you were with, God makes sure they don't like you so that you don't go back. I've seen the Lord, I'm off track, I'm on track, but I've seen the Lord wreck a romantic relationship on purpose because you're not with who you're supposed to be. With a great guy and a great gal, but just not supposed to be that because God's got somebody else. And how many know the best person you should be with is the person you're supposed to be with? Thus, Kathy did pretty well. So back to my point where I'm going. Saul is in no man's land. And chapter 9, verse 26. When Saul came to Jerusalem, he was trying to associate with the disciples, but they were afraid of him, not believing he was a disciple. Ah, here we go again. I don't know why this keeps happening. Verse 27, but Barnabas. I love those two words. But Barnabas took a hold of Saul and took him before the apostles and told them everything that happened to Saul. And that was the beginning of a new day for Saul, as Bill so powerfully shared again this morning. Something about someone who takes a hold of you, somebody that believes in you. Somebody that believes in you before you've actually proven yourself, before you're actually trustworthy. You haven't proven yourself trustworthy. And the possibility is you may not be trustworthy until that person takes a hold of you and begins to pour into your life and says, there's something about you. You're just beautiful. You're just amazing. You know, last week I exhorted us that we both need a Barnabas, and I said this last week, some of us are just one Barnabas away from being a world changer. Maybe just one Mordecai, you know, Mordecai with was Esther. Maybe some of us, I wonder how many of us are just one Barnabas, just one Mordecai from being a world changer. And here's the second thing I said last week, there's two main points, is what if you became one for someone else? And the truth is, I think that whatever you need, you give away. Somebody wrote me yesterday on Facebook and said, oh, I went to this church and no one liked me and no one invited me over and da da da. No one called me. And I just wrote back and said, phone rings both ways. Whatever you want, give it away and you'll get it back. I didn't say it'd be easy. I just said, if you want it, give it away. So someone's like, I wish someone would come and be a Barnabas to me. It's amazing what happens when you become one to someone else. And so I want to talk a little bit about that tonight and just say this, that there's three levels of connection, and I want to share with you some things I'm learning from a TED talk that my son sent me the next day. He said, Dad, you got to hear this TED talk. It's like a whole bunch of stuff that you were sharing in a different venue. But people belong, they believe, and they behave in that order. They belong, then they believe, then they behave. We probably would all love people to behave so that we could let them belong, so that we could get them to believe. How many would agree with that? But the truth is that that's not the way it happens. They belong, then they believe, then they behave. And this researcher, and by the way, I'd really encourage you to get on. Have you guys watched TED Talks? Any of you guys see TED Talks? By the way, many of them are awesome. This woman, her name's Breen Brown, and she did this talk called The Power of Vulnerability. Has anyone seen that? If you haven't seen it, get on and watch it. It's got one cuss word in it. I just have to say that to people because they're like, it had a cuss word in it. I'm like, I don't know how you get through life, but all right. Seriously. I know you know what I'm saying, Bill. It's like, from the podium, you recommend something that had a cuss word in it. I'm like, how do you actually get through life? I mean, life isn't that safe, you know? Help me, Jesus. Anyway, she's a social researcher who has 3 degrees in social work. And some years ago, she set out to find out what is the core root issues. What is the, is there a core root issue that drives dysfunction in society? And she, so for 6 years, she studied, she planned to study for 2 years, and she ended up studying for 6 years. What is the core root issue of society? And she said before she could find the core root issue, she had to figure out what the core root need of humanity was. And this is what she found out. She could have just read the Bible, it meant so much faster. You know, hey, it's in chapter 1 there, right there. John. She said the core root need of every human being is a need for connection, a sense of love and belonging. And she says that it's neurobiologically that connection, I don't even know what neurobiologically means, and neither does my computer because it said I spelt it wrong. But I didn't. She said that humanity is wired neurobiologically for connection, and that therefore from divine design, we are designed to need to be connected. And in this talk, she said to one another, we would all say to God. And we would probably say God first, people, but sometimes in Christianity, we say God, all you need is God. That's actually not true. It's not true because it's not the way you were designed. It's not the way God designed you. He designed you to need him and to need people. And she said that connection is what gives meaning to our lives. And she said the greatest enemy, and as she studied, and you have to get on there. I'm not going to do this justice. I'll repeat some of her points, but we're going someplace with it that I don't think that she went really. But she said that the greatest enemy of connection is shame. And she said shame is actually the fear of disconnection. She said shame says, I'm not good enough, I'm not pretty enough, I'm not smart enough, I'm not spiritual enough. There's something about me that isn't good enough. And she said, everybody in the world has those feelings at different points in their life. Some people live in them, but everyone has experienced the fear of not being enough. And she said, the fear of not being enough is what drives the dysfunction of all society. The fear of not being enough keeps people from connecting. In other words, the real issue is I'm not connected. I'm not loved. I don't love myself. I'm not connected to people, and we would say, and to God. And she said, what's driving that is the sense that I don't deserve to be. That if you knew me, you wouldn't like me because there's something inherently wrong with me and I'm never enough. And she said, the more that you don't talk about the more that you don't talk about shame, this is her quote, the more you probably have it. And this is what she said. So she started doing research. So this is her first 2 years. And by the way, it's kind of funny. She intended to do 2 years research. She ended up in 6 years of it, of researching the issues of humanity. She got 2 years into it and she crashed because she figured out that actually she had spent her whole life living in shame. And until she saw it in somebody else, she couldn't describe what it was in her, but she couldn't connect. And she ends up in a therapist's in therapy for a year, which you should, I mean, it's just a funny video. Yeah, anywhere, there's a cuss word in there. so crazy. You know, some time ago, I ministered to this particular politician. And it was a really, it was one of those extraordinary meetings. And, you know, we don't always have those. You don't always have those. And sometimes God comes in a way that's just so, that you're doing things that are so beyond you. We've all had those experiences, right? It might be 5 minutes or it might be 5 hours. We sometimes have it up here when we're ministering and something, not something, Holy Spirit comes on you and you get anointed and you start doing things that you know you can't do. And so we were in this meeting, this is some time ago, and we were with some friends and ministering to this particular guy who was the head of a city. And as we started to share with him, this thing happens to me. I don't think I could quite describe it, but it's actually felt. I could actually feel it. It doesn't happen very often. Very often with me, it happens maybe 4 or 5 times a year to me. But whenever this feeling happens to me, and it's not really an emotion, it's really hard to describe, but I could feel it. As I started to share without that feeling, I just had this prophetic word for this guy that was maybe 5 minutes long. And as I'm sharing, whew, this thing I'm trying to describe to you, this manifestation in my body, actually manifested in my body, came on me. And whenever that happens, the emotion I have is extreme confidence. Like extreme confidence. And I start to say things that just flow out of me spontaneously, which I'm a pretty spontaneous person anyway, but this is coming from something else. It's coming from another level. And I began to tell him how to rearrange his entire city for almost 2 hours. I laid out a plan for him that I did not have when I walked in there. It was amazing. No, I mean, it was amazing. And I laid out, and he had never talked to a prophetic person before. He was a Baptist guy. I'm not saying Baptists aren't prophetic. I'm just saying this particular Baptist guy didn't know anything. And his a friend of his introduced us. And so when I was done, he said, when you talk to prophetic people, are you supposed to ask questions? He's a super smart guy. I said, oh, yes. So he starts asking me questions. And as he's asking me the question, I have no idea what the answer is. Have you ever had it happen? Like the guy's asking you a question. And you're like, as he's asking, I know where the question's going. I'm like, I have no idea what the answer to that question is. When he finishes the question, I absolutely know what to tell him. And so we spend another hour with him asking questions and me giving him answers that I didn't know. It was extraordinary. It was Acts 19. It was extraordinary. I came back and shared with a few people, Bill and some of the team. And it was amazing. And so we made a really good connect, and he's a really wonderful person. But I want to tell you just about this one thing. About a few months later, he called me. Well, he texted me and said, can we talk? And I thought, now I absolutely know what it was, but I didn't know then. I absolutely did not want to talk to him again. But I didn't know what it was. So he texted me and said, can we talk? And I said, sure, tomorrow. I had time today, but I just didn't have courage. And I couldn't figure out what it was in me that didn't want to talk to him, because we had such a great connect. And we had text back a few times, back and forth, so it wasn't like it was 3 months, 4 months before we had talked or anything, but we just text back and forth, which was fine. And he said, I have some questions to ask you, when he texted me back, and I'm like, well, now I really don't want to talk to him. So actually stalled for 2 or 3 days, and finally he's like, hey, can you talk, like today, is it possible? I have some things, I need to make some decisions. I need to talk to you, and I'm like, sure, so call me now. So he calls, and I don't know what it was. I had this overwhelming sense of anxiety, and I'm like, wow, you know, one of the best times I've ever had with a person on his level was at that guy's place. And now, for whatever reason, I am terrified of talking to this guy. Well, he calls me. We have this great conversation. He asks a couple questions. Again, I didn't know what the answers were. I had the same experience. I didn't feel anything this time, but I absolutely had the answers. By the time he finished the question, I said, well, I would do this, this, and this. He absolutely did that. About 4 months later, he sends me a newspaper article of where he did exactly what I said, and it was on the front page of his newspaper of his city. And he says, hey, I just want you to know I did what you told me, and here it is. Front page of the newspaper. He's called me a couple more times. I have the same thing every time he calls me. I'm listening to this lady talk. And by the way, I am not doing it justice. It, you know, she's talking from her personhood. I'm talking from the teaching I heard from her, at least the first part of this. And I realize that I have this thing, but I'm not enough. And the reason, and part of the reason is because he saw God. And he doesn't know me without that. He's never met me before that. So he knows me at this level. You don't know me. I know what I'm about to try to say, and I think you can anticipate it. It's like, he knows, he only knows me at this level. He's never, he hasn't experienced Kris. He's only experienced Kris. I don't live there. I mean, I wish I did. Though, let's be real, you don't either. Nobody in this building lives there. And the struggle was that I feared that he would measure everything else from that, and I wouldn't be enough. And I began to have panic that I wouldn't be enough. And I have this thing, and you guys probably know this, I will not perform. Like, I just, it isn't in me. I actually hate it. The idea that I wouldn't be authentic, I don't think I can do it. I mean, I don't think I could live in, it would be like lying to me. Not being authentic to me is, I know it's not true. I understand it's not true. Like if you're not being authentic sometimes, do not take this as a, I'm not cursing you. For me, not being authentic is like lying. Like, just can't do it. Like, I just can't do it. It's like, even if someone goes, hey, do you like my dress? I mean, my wife's been married to me for 40 years. I mean, it's just like, there's just, I understand what protocol is. I'm not stupid. I was raised by a very emotionally intelligent mom. My mom is extremely emotionally intelligent. I know what the right answer is. That's part of the struggle. I know I'm supposed to say yes or something similar. Anyway, all that to say, like, it's just not in me to not be authentic. It's just not in me. It just, it eats at me when I'm, it's not, we've all not been. I'm just saying, I have not been at times. It just eats me as if I lied. It just eats me. So when he called me, I'm like, I start to do my Kris Vallotton, the great prophet. And I heard the Lord say this is the first time I was telling you about that he called me. I hear the Lord say, that isn't who you are. Don't do that. Just be you. You're enough. Now, I got to tell you, I still didn't feel like enough, but I knew that I wasn't supposed to be Kris Vallotton, the great prophet, on the phone. And the Lord said, just let him experience you. It'll be fine. And so we've interacted since then, and my anxieties, I mean, I want to say this, I still have some anxiety, so I'm going to be real, but it's dramatically reduced because we've had real conversations on this level, and we like each other. I mean, we like each other's humanness in a good way. Does that make sense? I don't know. I wasn't trying to be funny, but I am funny. And so it goes like this. So she says, the number one need in life is connection. We would say relationship. Like, you need relationship. Need relationship with, we would say, with God and with people. She, you'll see in the video. And by the way, I understand she's a believer. But we would say, and she's talking to TED Talk, so, you know, it's probably a little different talking to Ted. I've never talked to Ted. I tried to get on there. They hadn't experienced me at this level. I really did. I even asked an agent, and they're like, I saw your stuff. That's all he said. He said, I saw your stuff. And he paused, a long pause. I said, does that mean I'm not going to be in TED Talks? He's like, I saw your stuff. He just repeated it. I'm like, all right, well, thank you. Fine, I'll just build my own TED Talk to be Kris Talks. No, don't clap when I'm being funny. That was just being funny. So she began to study this thing of shame, which she found out was actually guiding her entire life. And actually she realized that what she was actually studying her own pathway out of this dungeon, which was shame, and she was been locked in it since she was a little girl. And so she started, now she's got two things going. She's studying society and culture, and she's also trying to figure out how to get out. Because as she studied culture, she figured out that not only was the shame in the culture, but it was in her, and she was a prisoner of shame and had been her entire life. And so she started to interview people who come out of shame. This is powerful. And as a researcher, which would be interesting, and she found about five different qualities that I'd like to tell you about. The first one, she said that everyone who had walked out of shame had this one trait in common, vulnerability. And she called vulnerability the ability to be seen and known. And she said, vulnerability breaks the power of shame, and vulnerability says, I am loved, and I am enough, and I belong. Vulnerability. Vulnerability is the birthplace. She said this, vulnerability is the birthplace of joy, happiness, creativity, belonging, and love. And she said, every single person that walked out of shame was a person who learned to be vulnerable. And she said, she studied, I forget how many people, for 4 more years, she studied people who were stuck in shame that have spent their life in shame and people who have walked out of shame. And she said, the difference between people who were stuck in shame and the people who had walked out of shame is that the people who had walked out of shame had this one trait with their vulnerability. And she called it worthiness. She said, everybody who'd walked out of shame had this underlying sense that ultimately they were worthy. And she said, worthy is the belief that I deserve to be loved and belong. And she said, it's a difference between people who have a sense of love and belonging and those who don't. And then she said this, and the people that walk out of shame, they get out of shame, they have this other trait, number three. So number one is they're vulnerable. Number two, they have a sense of worthiness. And number three, they're courageous. And I thought this is interesting. She said the word courage comes from the Latin word cur, which means heart. And it literally means to tell the story of who you are with your whole heart. Courage means to tell the story of who you are with your whole heart. And courage, and she said, courage, the way that courage gets you out of shame is that the courage that you need to come out of shame is the courage to be imperfect and to love yourself. The courage to say to yourself, you're good enough even though you're flawed. And then she said, they have this one last thing. She said, they're authentic. And this, I love what she said about authenticity. She said, the authenticity is the ability to let go of who you think you should be so you can be who you really are. Authenticity is the ability to let go of who you think you should be so you can be who you really are. I had this encounter, I want to just read you what I wrote right after I had it. It was in Winston Churchill's house. He wasn't home. And frankly, I'm glad he wasn't. I wrote this the next day. Most things that are perfect are lifeless, mechanical, plastic replicas of the real thing. Many people live a photoshopped life, flaws, frailties, and weaknesses masked by pretend smiles, carefully crafted words, and finely polished images. There's a certain inherent beauty in real life, worn patterns in wood floors that reveal pathways and passions, marks on the thresholds marred by those whose lives toiled there. I visited Winston Churchill's home. It was a large rustic mansion with hand-hewed beams and plank floors. Many tourists were impressed by the trophies that filled the cabinets that hung in many places in many of the rooms. Personally, I was drawn to the worn places in certain rooms where Winston must have walked and knelt often. A discolored leather chair captured my attention where Winston sat a lot. I imagined him seated there during the tough days of war, contemplating and praying for wisdom or pacing the floor in deep thought. A well-used desk stood proudly in a den that once served as the place where Winston Churchill crafted many of his speeches. I was overwhelmed by a sense of nobility that filled the entire room. I loved that home. I love that the home was lived in, imperfect, marred, scarred, and worn. There was an intrinsic beauty about the old mansion, walls that told stories, floors that whispered secrets, antique furniture that begged to reveal mysteries. I sat on a bench outside his front door for a long time, just reflecting on the revelation that was seeping into my soul by simply being in the same place that was once occupied by a broken but great man. I like my machines, my iPad, car, and computer to be perfect, shiny, and flawless. But the beauty of humanity lies in flaws, in frailties, and weaknesses. Real might be rustic, but at least it's alive and not robotic, programmed, and predictable. There's something about real that's beautiful. Then there's something about going into a brand new house that's beautiful. But there's something about going into an old mansion that was inhabited by a great man that you don't want them to paint over the floors. You don't want them to carpet over the marred pathways of where that great man or that great woman walked. It would be a tragedy to take out the old desk and put a new one in, or to plaster over the scratches on the thresholds of the doorway. There's something about the intrinsic beauty of real and authentic. Something about scars that become beautiful stories. Wounds that become windows into your soul that tell stories about you and God and you and your family. I guess I'm saying that social networking has created a world that's not believable. Photoshop pictures and profiles of who you want to be and not who you really are. Pictures that are taken on your best moments that create an unrealistic life. I love what Eric said a couple of months ago. He said, when you're in a fight with your wife, nobody takes a picture of that and posts it on Instagram and says, here we are in a big fight. And what happens in society is that we create this, are you with me? We create this new house feel, this new car smell, and on social networking, and it raises the level of what life's supposed to be like. And when you live anything besides that, you start to feel like I'm not enough. I'm not good enough. These people are living, they live up here. And it becomes a pressure to make people believe you live up here because you don't want to be enough either, because the number one need in life is to be connected. And who wants to connect with someone who's not enough? She said this, she said, I thought I had a breakdown, but my therapist said I was having a spiritual awakening. That's the truth. About the time you think you're having a breakdown, you have a breakthrough. There's something about humility that exalts you. Somebody said that. And she said, what we do with shame when we don't know how to be vulnerable, authentic, courageous, or feel worthy is that we numb shame. And I thought this was a profound statement. She said, the problem with numbing shame is you can't selectively numb pain. You can only numb. And when you numb, you not only numb pain, but you numb joy, pleasure, excitement, and every other human emotion. You just live numb. And she said this, she said, blame is the primary way we discharge shame, pain, and discomfort. She said, blame is the primary way we numb shame. We blame other people. It's not my fault. It's not my fault I live like this. I'm a victim. I'm a powerless little victim living among giants, and nothing that ever went wrong is my fault. And how many of you know that cycle? And it goes like this, I feel unworthy, therefore I feel ashamed. Because I feel ashamed, I hide. And when I hide, I'm disconnected. And when I'm disconnected, I feel unworthy. And when I feel unworthy, I'm ashamed. When I'm ashamed, I hide. When I hide, I'm disconnected. When I'm disconnected, I feel unworthy, and I end up in this ecosystem that I can't get off of because it feeds itself. And the more I disconnect, the more it validates that I'm not enough. I'm not enough. Well, what's the truth? So this is a beautiful part of the message that we have both learned and are learning. And that is the truth is that Jesus didn't die for junk. Amen. Yeah. That actually he bought the whole field so he could get the treasure. And by the way, you had a treasure. In fact, the command on you and me is that I'm to love my neighbor as I love myself. And I do not have permission to not love me. As a matter of fact, the way I love me is the way I love you. And the best thing I can do for you is love me. And when Paul was trying to solve some relational issues, or seemingly in the book of Ephesians between husbands and wives, he says, husbands, love your wife as you love yourself. No one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it. So husbands ought to love your wives as you love your own flesh. And he begins to tell husbands, you know what's wrong with your marriage? You don't love you. And that's why you don't love her. Now, I'm not talking about this self-centered, you would know this, but just because we're streaming. I didn't say screaming, I said streaming. I'm not talking about self-centered, it's all about me. I'm just talking about loving the person Jesus made you to be and stop pretending and stop calling hating yourself humility. It's not humility, it's stupidity. And it's leading to shame, which is getting you stuck and keeping you from actually loving your neighbor and loving God. And the truth is, 2 Corinthians 5:21, he made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf. Listen to this. So that we might become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And the truth is, you're enough. I don't think you heard me. I said, the truth is, you are enough. I said, I'm not enough. Well, Jesus is enough. Yes, Jesus is enough. And he said, I made you enough. I made you the righteousness of God. Listen, you are the righteousness of God. You are personified righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Matthew 5:14, you are the light of the world, a city set on a hill that won't be hidden. 2 Peter 1:4 says that you actually have the divine nature. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says that if any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. Old things have passed away. Listen, these are verses you know well, but these are verses that lead you out of shame, because this is the truth and shame is a lie. Shame is not your friend. It's your enemy, and sometimes it masquerades as conviction. I'd say shame is counterfeit conviction. How many of you know, condemnation, shame, says you lied, you're a liar. The reason why you lied is because you are inherently bad. Conviction says you're way too awesome to be acting like that. You're acting below your nature. When you lie, conviction says, hey, you're a child of the king. You are royalty, nobility. You have a divine nature. You are filled with glory. That isn't who you are. Stop acting below your nature. And shame makes, I'm sorry, conviction makes you feel powerful, but shame makes you feel powerless. How do I know what it is? Do you feel powerless? Do you feel stuck? Yeah, that's shame. And shame says, you need me so you won't do it again. You looked at porn. Listen, you need to stay feeling bad about yourself. If you stay feeling really bad about yourself and you punish yourself for doing that, you won't do it again. But the truth is, you need to be powerful to not do it again. And shame takes away your power and makes you feel like you're Pee Wee Herman instead of the son of Jesus Christ. I don't know, I hope Pee Wee's not around. Woohoo, sorry, Pee Wee Herman. Ephesians 5:1, be imitators of God. How many know, be imitators of God as beloved children. You were made in his image and likeness. All these things we've shared before, but in this context, it's powerful because when I imitate God, I'm being myself. I'm called to be like God. I'm supposed to be Christ-like. I'm not supposed to be like God. Well, Christ is God. Hello. Somebody wrote me and they said, you said that we're supposed to be like God, and I think that's heresy. I said, wrote back, said, are we supposed to be like Jesus? He's like, yes. Like, do you believe in the Trinity? Father, Son, Holy Spirit, one God? Just people haven't thought through this. Whatever. I love this verse, 2 Corinthians 3:18. But we're all y'all. We should have a Texas Bible. Because some of them words, you know what I mean? They're just more accurate. All you all with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory as the Lord, the Spirit. That's just a good word. I love this quote. C.S. Lewis said this, the fact that our heart yearns for something earth can't supply is proof that heaven must be our home. Is that amazing? The fact that our heart yearns for something earth can't supply is proof that heaven must be our home. Romans 8:28 says this, we know that God causes all things to work together for good for those who love God and are called according to his purposes. For whom he foreknew, he predestined. And whom he predestined, he called. And whom he called, he justified. And whom he justified, he glorified. Why do all things work together for good? Because you were predestined for glory from the foundation of the world. You were born to rock. You were born to rock. I just want to finish with a few thoughts. We started out this message a couple of weeks ago by saying to people, saying and challenging you to take hold of somebody. That everybody needs somebody to take hold of them. Build that for me. I did a revival chat this week, which is a sit-down chat with my beautiful and lovely daughter-in-law, Lauren, who I love with my whole heart. And she asked me a question, what's one of the most defining moments in your life? Well, the most defining moment was finding Jesus. The second most defining moment was finding Kathy. The third most defining moment was finding Bill. I still remember, I've told the story many times. The hippie pastor. Yeah. I can actually remember the very first sermon he ever preached in Weirville, and I bet he can't remember it, but I can. First of all, I wasn't on the board at the time. I was 1 year out of a nervous breakdown. I'd been 2 years in a nervous breakdown, and they said, we got a new pastor, which we had been without for a while. I don't remember how long, months, maybe a year. And I was like, well, that's cool. And then Bill came in. So the first time I ever saw Bill was, at least that I think that I ever saw Bill, but that I knew that he was gonna be our pastor for sure, was on a Sunday morning. And I think there was like 40 people in our church, something like that. It was very small. And so, you know, we did our normal thing, and then Bill came up to preach. And when he came up, it was a hippie pastor. I'm like, dude, I don't need a hipster. I need a dad. And then he started to share. You ever have preconceived ideas about people? No, none of you ever do. Do you ever think, man, that guy looks dumb? And then they open their mouth and you're like, by the way, Bill didn't look dumb. He looked like a hippie with his flower child wife. Totally, she never came out of it. Which I'm thankful for. And I know that Bill is too. And Bill started to share. And I had never heard a human being share the scriptures like that in my life. It's a true story. I sat there stunned. I'm like, where did he get that? I was like reading out the Bible. I don't know how he does it. Like, is this just the emphasis or? It's like, I don't know. He's like, just trying to find a passage I can read real quickly, you know. I don't know how he does it. Like, people still say it today. It's like, Bill Johnson said it. I'm like, it's Jesus Christ, it's a quote of Jesus Christ. I've said it 50 times. They're like, Bill Johnson says, they put it on Twitter. Bill Johnson said, that is an exact quote of Jesus Christ. I am sorry, but Jill Johnson did not particularly say that. And I love this man, but he didn't say all of that. And I don't know what it is. It's probably why you're here too. One of the reasons is something about, there's something that happens when somebody says to you, I'm not saying they necessarily say these exact words, but they say, you are enough. You don't have to hide anymore. I like you. I don't like you. I like you. I just like you. Like, you're enough. Like, I actually like your flaws. And by the way, I just want to separate just for a minute, just for the sake of, I'm not talking about sin. I'm saying we love people in their sin. We don't love people because of their sin. That's just want to make a little difference because of the rest I want to say. So when I say flaws, I'm not talking about sin. But it's, there's something that happens when people love your flaws. Like the little things that you're like, I'm kind of quirky. And people are like, that's why I like you. Like, don't paint over that. Like, I'm gonna go learn how to not do that. They're like, no, that's who you are. You'll be like all the other track houses if you do that. I'm gonna tear this down. I'm gonna build me something contemporary. No, don't do that. It's all metaphors. Are you with me? No, don't do that. I'm gonna get me a new cat. I'm gonna refurnish this house of mine. No. We actually like the worn places of your life. Like, please don't be different. And that doesn't give us permission to not change. Of course, I'm saying there's something about people who love you for you. There's something about people who take a hold of you for you. To me, this is evangelism. When you say to people, you're enough. I know we want to say, here's all your sins. I think the Holy Spirit does that. This is maybe not right. I just think Holy Spirit does that. And there's something about people who are convicted of sin before they're convinced of a Savior. That's tough. Until you go, you're enough. Hey, you don't have to hide anymore. Come connect with me. Oh, if you knew me, you wouldn't like me. No, no, I know you and I like you. You don't have to live disconnected anymore, numbing your pain with stuff, with drugs and alcohol and sex. You're just numbing your shame. And when you numbed your shame, you numbed your joy. Come on and just be fully alive right here and happen. Just happen. Funny thing in my life, three men have believed in me in my life. Probably more, but I mean, I'm talking about when the flaws were like, the whole building was falling down. It's like, I don't know if that's livable. You know, there's flaws and then there's like, the barn fell down. Okay, anyway, metaphor didn't work, but it's not too hard. You know, Proverbs says this, everybody's a friend of the rich, but who can find a friend of the poor? I don't think he's just talking about money. When people get famous or, you know, they get good at what they do and you're like, oh, you're so amazing. Let me give you a prophecy about what you're already doing. Not very hard. Not very hard. Well, it's pretty hard to love a Peter who continually screws up. And you're like, hey, I think you're going to be in charge. You're going to deny me, then you're going to come back. And I love this part, you know, because when Jesus told Mary, he said, go tell my disciples and Peter. It wasn't because he didn't think Peter was a disciple. It was because she knew she didn't. It wasn't because Jesus didn't think Peter's not one of my disciples. So go tell the 10 and Peter. It wasn't like that. It was like, he knew if he told her, go tell the disciples, that she wouldn't tell Peter because Peter was already considered a traitor. They thought there was two traitors, Judas and Peter. But Jesus had to remind her there was only one. And by the way, the guy who messed up the most besides Judas for the first many years was the head of the church. Something happens when someone believes in you. My grandfather believed in me way before I deserved it. No stories. Yeah. It's interesting. My grandfather didn't believe in the rest of the kids. He only believed in me. I became Joseph that the rest of the kids didn't like. I never tell that part of the story. And then Bill Derryberry believed in me. A name like Derryberry, that's great for real estate. What's the guy's name? I don't know, Dingleberry? Something about berries. I mean, seriously, you'd have to give yourself that name. You know, I've always wanted to have like a short name like Cher. You don't need a last name. You either want to have a name like Cher or Derryberry. No one could ever forget you. You remember me? Yeah, you're the Dingleberry, the something about berries. And Bill Johnson. Those are the three men that believed in me in my life. And I think that we need to be that for somebody. This is the second time I've said this in two messages, but something about inviting people out of shame. Would you stand? Let me just pray for y'all. How many would love someone to come along and really believe in you, like a Barnabas? How many would love that to happen? Cool. All y'all, you need to do that for somebody. So I want to pray for you, and I want to pray that the Lord would give you one person. You should do more, but one person, listen to what I'm going to say, who's not obvious. Someone who actually needs you to believe in them. No, it's like, I'd like to be a friend of the guy who's, you know, it's like, well, that guy's already famous. He don't need you. But I want you to think of one person. So I want you to close your eyes for a moment. And Holy Spirit, I pray that you would just give them a picture of somebody they're supposed to believe in who is hard to believe in. Maybe not lovely, maybe hiding in shame. Maybe there's lots of reasons why people don't believe in her or him. And I pray right now that you would give everyone in the room a picture, an image of somebody that you've assigned for them to be a Barnabas to. And I guess if you're a woman, a Barnett. Whatever. I'm still praying. Amen. Thank you very much. Bless you.
Thank you for joining us. On our website, ibethel.org, we have our pastor's itineraries who may be visiting a place near you. Danny Silk will be in Brandenburg, Germany, August 6th through the 9th, and Bill Johnson will be in Nashville, Tennessee, August 10th through the 14th. Now, we want to hear from you. If you have any prayer requests, you can email them to pastor@bethel.tv. Our team would love to pray for you. And be sure to send us your testimonies as well. We've recently heard a testimony from Jackie Durant, who was ministering to a woman in Portland. This woman had an illness involving three nerves causing extreme pain in her jaw. As Jackie was praying, she felt the Holy Spirit and asked if this woman had experienced three injustices in her life that made her feel like she had to keep her mouth shut. The woman began to sob and said yes, and as they prayed, the pain was eliminated. We pray that the justice and redemption of God would come into every area of your life, eliminating all pain and disease. We release the goodness of God over you by the power of the Holy Spirit so that you can receive every good thing that Jesus paid for. Thank you for watching Bethel TV and joining us and our Bethel family around the world. We hope to see you again soon.